So let's continue. Quick revision. We said first law is our understanding of the behavior of adiabatic systems. We defined what is meant by adiabatic systems. Then we generalized the behavior of adiabatic systems, understood that W adiabatic is independent of some paths, so should represent change in some property. That property we took as energy to be consistent with other branches of physics, giving you a definition of delta E, that is thermodynamic energy of the system, as minus W adiabatic. Minus is a matter of sign convention, the second sign convention. Then we did the definition of heat interaction, that was this. Again, mind you, there is a sign convention involved here, because we could have defined it as W12 minus W12 adiabatic, or we could have defined it the other way, W adiabatic 12 minus W12. But we define it this way again as a matter of sign convention, because this way we are consistent with the nomenclature or the convention that the heat absorbed by a system is positive, heat rejected by a system is negative. If I were to define it the other way, WAD12 minus W12, it would be heat rejected by the system to be positive and heat absorbed by the system to be negative. For some reason, historically and traditionally, perhaps because of our link with the caloric theory of heat, caloric was a fluid. So when something is gained, it is positive. Something is lost, it is negative. So we have physicists, chemists, engineers all work with the convention, but a convention that heat absorbed by a system is positive, heat rejected by a system is negative. Okay, and we are consistent with that definition. Now, adiabatic work being independent of the path is first law. Defining that as an energy change is the definition of energy. For a non-adiabatic process, agreeing that W12 need not be equal to W adiabatic 12. That's obvious because we have said first law is actually characteristic of adiabatic processes. So the difference, if any, is defined as the heat transfer 12. And finally, the final form can now be written down as, I will just drop the suffixes, Q equals W plus delta E. This is the final form for any process. The differential form will be dQ equals dW plus dE. At this stage, it is necessary for us to emphasize that dE being the differential of a property is an exact differential, like dx or dy, whereas dQ and dW are not exact differentials. And to emphasize that, quite often we cross the stem of these, or while typing we prime d prime q or d prime w. Okay? It's not necessary to write it, but what is necessary is to understand and be always conscious of the fact that dq and dw are inexact differentials, whereas dE is an exact differential. And because of that, delta E is a property change. It is a point function, difference in energy between two points, whereas Q and W are path functions. So if you have the same states 1 and 2, delta E for any process between the two states is fixed. It is E1 minus E2, whereas Q may be different, W may be different if the processes are different. Then again, to emphasize that the units of E, units of W and units of Q are the same. And this is for any process, this is for a differential process, for a process element, And mind you, for a small change in state, this can always be written. But if you go on accumulating that small change, unless it's a quasi-static process, you can't integrate this. Okay. Whenever it's integration of a differential, quasi-static process is a necessary. That should again be emphasized. Then let's consider a cycle. Cycle means one is the same thing as two. And hence, delta E is 0. And that means Q over a cycle should be W over a cycle. Something which we know, but this is our proper derivation of that. Now, before taking questions, which I know there will be a number of them, I will make a statement which had sometimes got me into trouble, but I have properly come out of it. And that statement is that we should now realize that with in our scheme of things, this is not only is the end form of first law, and remember the restriction here is we are considering a process. And the process is that of a closed system. We are saying fixed mass. We have not considered any mass flow here. But what I am going to say is that we should also realize that this is the only equation being the definition of Q which relates Q to the rest of the world. If during our study of thermodynamics, if we come across any relation which doesn't obviously look like this, relating Q to something else, that relation must be a derivation from this relation. There is no other independent relation linking Q with the rest of the world, except of course the second law of thermodynamics where it will vaguely get related to delta S. But so long as there is no entropy around, purely from an energy point of view, this is the only relation between Q and the rest of the world. And that relation for second law is a relation for delta S, it's not a relation for Q. This is the defining relation for Q, and if you have any other relation, that must be a derivative of this and derivable from this. Okay, questions?
Sir, actually, W adiabatic. Is independent of path.
Adiabatic is?
Independent of path, you are told.
Adiabatic work is independent of path.
Adiabatic work is independent of path. But actually the work in general is depends on path.
Yes, general work depends on path, and that is why we have said that if a process is not adiabatic, the work done need not be equal to each other, and the work done hence need not be equal to the adiabatic work.
Then we
but if you have two states, 1 and 2, and execute any number of adiabatic processes from 1 to 2, the work done in each and every one should be the same. That is the discovery realization which has been used to formulate the first law of thermodynamics.
So what I have feel
in fact,
now…
that exactly is the first law.
What I have feel now is, there must be a only one path between 1 and 2 if it is adiabatic. It is true or not?
No, not necessary. That will be true if you say that you have only one mode of work, the path is quasi-static, and maybe some other restrictions. If you put those restrictions, then there will be only one path. But adiabatic means only work done. If you have more than one mode of work between 1 and 2, you can have any number of adiabatic paths.
So can you give example?
Examples will follow when we do the examples. Yes, madam.
We have come across the definition for adiabatic as where there is no heat transfer, we call that
yes,
adiabatic.
Yes, yes, yes. But there are, agree that this, our definition of adiabatic means work transfer only. After defining Q, adiabatic is saying equivalent to no heat transfer. But if you try to define adiabatic meaning that there is no heat transfer, you have to define what is meant by heat transfer before that.
Whether it is between the system and the surroundings.
Okay, but how do you define heat transfer between system A and system B? We have not yet defined before defining adiabatic, and hence we will not define adiabatic as no heat transfer. It's another way of saying work transfer only. Okay. But we say work transfer only because till we define heat transfer, we don't want to use the word heat. Okay. Just the way we have talked about temperature, but we have not defined temperature, so we have not related anything to temperature. In fact, you will find that unless we define temperature now, we can't proceed significantly beyond this. We can't solve any problems. And Professor, that's what we will come to now.
Professor, the W 1 to 2 minus W adiabatic 1 to 2.
Yes.
Whether the W 1 to 2 is greater than the WAD 1 to?
No. If it is greater than WAD 1 to, then Q 1 to will be a positive number. If it is less than WAD 1 to, Q 1 to will be a negative number. There is no restriction on the sign of Q12. Nothing is greater than something else. All I said is it need not be equal to. And this need not be equal to, as I explained, means it can be equal to, it can be greater than, it can be less than. If it happens to be equal to, well, the net Q12 will be 0. That will be a overall adiabatic process. If W12 is greater than this, Q12 will be positive. We will say heat is absorbed by the system in our traditional nomenclature. If W12 is less than W12 adiabatic, then Q12 will be negative, and we will say in our traditional terms, heat is rejected by the system. Now, the next step is the following. It was just pointed out that delta E has different components, yes. W has different components, yes. So what we will now do is our first law, which we said was Q equals delta E plus W. We will split delta E into different components. And before that, we will split W into different components because W came first. So let us say that W is made up of various modes. It could be expansion, it could be stirrer, it could be electrical, it could be surface tension, plus what have you. More complicated the system, more these work modes are possible. Some of them could be two-way, some of them could be one-way. And again, I emphasize two-way, one-way, because we will come back to it when we come to the next version of the state postulate. Now, we also know that energy is not unique to thermodynamics, the idea of energy. It has occurred in mechanics, fluid mechanics, electricity, magnetism, gravitation, whatever you have. So, we know that E is made up of some components. For example, there will be a delta E kinetic plus delta E potential of various kinds. There could be gravitational potential, there could be electric potential, there could be magnetic potential. So you can even sum this up over all such potential energies of other kinds. Okay. Delta E kinetic would be delta of mv squared. Delta E potential gravitational would be delta mg delta h, assuming g is uniform, or if you have g varying, you integrate it out with local g into dh. After taking care of all this, if you say that you execute a process in which you assure that kinetic energy is not changing, potential energy is not changing of any kind. But then the question arises that if I execute an adiabatic process in which I see to it that there is no change in the gravitational potential energy, it stays where it is, there is no change in kinetic energy, my system does not accelerate or decelerate, There is no change in magnetic field, no change in surface area. So all other energies are restricted to not change. In that case, I can still do work on the system. That's a discovery. And hence, we say that there must be an component of internal component of energy which is unrelated to anything else in physics. That component that remains, we call it as the thermal internal energy. The reason why traditionally it has been called internal is that it does not have to do with anything external like position, velocity, etc. So even other components, for example, kinetic energy, it is measurable by means of velocity. You have an external frame of reference. Gravitational potential, you have to measure something with respect to a datum. So these are sort of external variables coming into picture. Whereas electrical energy, chemical energy, nuclear energy, these are all internal. There is nothing external to measure. We have the potential inside, the charge inside, and that gives us the electrical energy. The magnetic induction and the field inside gives us the magnetic energy. Chemical energy, depending on the concentrations and the components, we can determine. These are considered sort of internal energy. We do not have to look at external variables. So that is why this thermal energy, because it does not depend on external variable, depends purely on the local state of the system, is known as thermal internal energy. But a better nomenclature would simply be thermal energy. So our nomenclature would be for this thermodynamic energy or the total energy which contains all components, and when you remove components pertaining to other branches of physics, what remains is the thermal energy. And the traditional nomenclature is U, and because we are writing in the delta form, it is delta U. Quite often in our simple problems, we will not have other components. So it is okay to write Q equals delta U plus W. But make it a habit, force the student to write always Q equals delta E plus W, and make an assumption that delta E equals delta U. Let the student be conscious of this fact, because suddenly you have a problem, one problem of a sack falling from a height of 30 or 40 meters. If you use delta U, you will be wrong, because there is a change in potential energy which has to be taken care of. Whenever a student writes Q equals delta U plus W and not delta U plus PdV, he should be conscious of the fact that delta E could be delta U plus something else. So let him make an assumption that delta E equals delta U. When he makes an assumption, he may realize that, look, apart from delta U, there could be something else. And similarly, let him write it as W, and then let him write as W is W expansion only. When he stops at W expansion, he should quickly think, hey, are there other components? Read the problem. Does it mention a stirrer? Does it mention electrical work? All these things. Okay. So it's a good idea to solve our first law problems always from this equation. And don't replace immediately delta E with delta U. Let that be the first step as appropriate. Now look at this equation. A simple equation, three terms. So that means given two terms, I can find the third, nothing special about it. But okay, I can measure W. If Q is 0, I can determine delta E, or by some reason, if I have measured Q and W, I have determined delta E. But see, E or delta U, the thermal part of it, is a property of the system. It is not directly measurable. I need some property by which I can have a handle over it. So now the question that arises is the following, and that slowly brings us to the Zeroth law. Delta E is change in some property E. Now the question is on what does E depend and how? That is the next question that we have to solve for. But since we know that E has a number of components, let us restrict ourselves to U, because we know how the other components are evaluated. If we know the velocity, we know the kinetic energy change. If we know the change in level, we know the gravitational energy change. So let us ask ourselves the more pertinent question, that how is delta E to be related to the property, other properties of the state. And that brings us to the subsequent section, how many properties fix the state of a system? Is it 2? Is it 3? Is it 4? And which ones? That brings us to the state postulate again, and that brings us also to the number of two-way work modes. This which ones are not really dictated by thermodynamics. Okay. We will take a forward link to one part of thermodynamics which is known as the phase rule. We will not derive it, but we will use it because we are going to work with water and steam, two phases together. The phase rule tells us the conditions under which pressure and temperature are independent and the conditions under which pressure and temperature are not independent. Okay. That is all it does. But thermodynamics, using the state postulate, will tell us how many properties are required to define uniquely the state of a system, but thermodynamics will not tell us which properties. Okay. And that brings us to state postulate. Which I may call state postulate 1, but in most books this is mentioned only as a state postulate. Hardly any book or very few books will talk of state postulate 1, which we discussed yesterday, that the state of a thermodynamic system can always be defined using only primitive variables. Okay. It does not say how many, but it says that only primitive variables are necessary. It may not be always the most convenient one, but only primitive variables can be used to define the state. The state postulate says that if we have a system of fixed mass, that means a closed system, then the number of independent intensive variables. Intensive, actually, because of fixed mass, intensive now includes intensive as well as specific, equals number of two-way work modes plus. This is the state postulate, the second part of state postulate, and because it is a postulate, it is a premise. We do not have a proof for this. Okay. Now, under certain assumptions about type of system and type of work modes, using mathematics, one can sort of do a differential analysis and show that this is derivable. But mathematics using differential geometry, it is so esoteric that we will leave it at a postulate. We will not seek a proof of this. Okay. Now, what is the consequence of this? Remember, this one is important, and that will bring us to our property known as temperature. We have seen that suppose you have a fluid like a gas, what is the number of two-way work modes it has? 1. So, how many properties are required to to fix the state of a system of containing a gas of fixed mass? Two. That's all it says. It doesn't say which two. Okay, it could be pressure volume, it should be pressure temperature. Mass is already fixed, so that's not a variable. Or anything, tomorrow you define entropy, maybe entropy temperature would define the state, entropy pressure would define the state, entropy enthalpy would define the state. So long as they are independent, shown to be independent by some other thing, the number of properties will be 2. So this means that we have defined simple systems. N2W is 1, so 2 properties are needed. And this is the reason whenever we talk of air, water and some such fluid system where the number of two-way work mode is 1, compression and expansion, we always say pressure temperature. When we say air at 3 bar 300 degrees C, we are happy, we know everything about the air. But the reason we are happy is because of state postulate, air being a fluid with only a single two-way work mode, 2 properties are sufficient. Okay. But the moment you have a complex system, say an electrolyte, expand contract as well as charge discharge, number of two-way work modes is 2, you will need 3 properties. More complex the system, higher be the number of properties needed. And at this stage, many books will have definitions which we should make the students comfortable with. A system which has a single work mode is known as a simple system. If that single work mode is that of expansion compression, we will call it a simple compressible system. Okay? If that, for example, the cell in my mobile, it is a simple electrical system because the only two-way work mode is charging and discharging. Okay. Similarly, you take a simple elastic rod, extension and compression is the only work mode. Assume that it is constrained not to get twisted and bent. So we will call it a simple elastic system. Similarly, a soft iron piece, assuming that you can't compress it or expand it, you can only magnetize it and demagnetize it. That will be a simple magnetic system. But if that soft iron piece can be extended and compressed, then you can magnetize it, demagnetize it, expand it, extend it, compress it, that will be a complex system, 2 two-way work modes. Okay. So this way, because most of the books will be talking of a simple compressible substance, simple electrical substance and so on, we will not use the word substance. Everything for us is a system. Whatever is inside the system is some substance, that's okay. But we will always define a simple compressible system. Because unless it is a system, thermodynamic system, we will not talk about it. So the proper thing would be, although the book says substance, we will say okay, the substance which is contained in that system. But actually the characteristic of being simple compressible, simple electrical is that of the system. Okay, so we will properly talk about a simple compressible system, a simple compressible, simple electrical system and so on. And now remember that unless we really talk about properties, we are not really worried about what is inside a system. We have always been talking about the system. Inside the system is like a black box. So long as we know what its state is, it can be anything. We all need its properties. Okay, so we don't really have to be talking about a substance. We will always be talking about a system. Now, before we go further, we have said that there are substances or there are systems which yesterday I called rudimentary systems. Here, number of two-way work modes is 0. What is the number of properties needed to define the state of such a system? One property. And that is good, because if we were to have a thermodynamic system with 0 property, we will get into lots of problems. What do we do with thermodynamics then? So this indicates that even if there is no two-way work mode, there will be one property needed to define the state of a system. What is that one property? That's what thermodynamics doesn't say. And hence, because of that, suppose we have a mercury in glass thermometer. The only property we know, the only thing which can change, is the length of the thread of mercury in the capillary. We have mapped it to temperature, but the basic property is that length of the thread, which can be very easily measured. Okay. That brings us to the idea of a temperature, but we must now formalize what we mean by temperature, and for that we move to Zeroth law. I do not have to write of thermodynamics, although I should really write it, I leave it to write it, but Zeroth law is unique to thermodynamics for the simple reason I do not think there is any other science which has a Zeroth law associated with it. Is there one? Newton's law is first, second. In electromagnetism there are some laws which are, but there is no Zeroth law. Those laws are usually named after people, Ampere's law and somebody else's law, Maxwell's laws, Maxwell's relations which come out of all those, but there is no Zeroth law. Now what is Zeroth law? What is your idea of Zeroth law? Let's hear, because every textbook has, usually it doesn't have a chapter on Zeroth law. Almost all thermodynamics textbooks for some reason talk of Zeroth law, usually in the very first chapter, finish it off in about a paragraph, talk about something called thermal equilibrium and say something and say lo and behold something called temperature comes out. We won't accept that. We want a proper formulation of Zeroth law. So what is your idea of Zeroth law?
Internal, the energy transfer from A to B.
Who is talking?
I am talking. The energy transfer, internal energy, we call it as in thermodynamics.
Because internal energy is property of a system. It can't be transferred. Anything which is transferred is only
energy is transferred. Energy is transferred in the means from
energy
A to B.
Energy is transferred. Yeah. Okay. Hey, by the way, something which I forgot, and a great analogy. Before going to this, again, this is something which you have to impress on your students. So I will see, let me write this as delta E is Q minus W. This is another way of writing first law, okay, just transpose terms. Delta E is change in property of a system. Okay. This Q minus W are interactions between systems. So this is not really complete, because we are talking of delta E of a system, Q and W with some other system, but we are not yet talked about delta E of that system. Okay, there will be first law applied to them. Of a system and between system means there must be two systems involved. This depends for this state only on the initial state and the final state. These depend on initial state, final state and the process detail. Okay. So we must emphasize on students that Q and W are interactions two systems are involved and both Q and W are energy in transit. That means while doing the interaction of either Q type or W type, there must be a transfer of energy from one system to another. Two systems are involved, a boundary must be involved. Unless the boundary is defined, you can't talk of a Q or a W. Okay? And there are two illustrations, one analogy and one illustration. One analogy is that of rain, which I found in a book by, a small book by a boxer, some 40 or 80 page book. So he talks of a cloud, okay, and then he says, well, I have converted it to, we have a lake. What do we have in cloud? Water in vapor form or in droplet form. What we have in the lake is water. Okay. Cloud bursts and forms a shower of rain. What is rain? Rain is the interaction between cloud and the water in the lake. Something comes out of the cloud, something goes into the lake. So rain is water in transit. Like heat and work. We don't say Pavai Lake now contains so many meter cube of rain. It contains so many meter cube of water. The cloud contained, cloud can't say, oh, that cloud has 250 millimeters of rain in it. No. Cloud has so many tons or so many meter cube of water vapor in it. But when that water gets transferred to the ground, the interaction is known as rain. If there is no rain, the amount of water in the cloud remains what it is. If there is no rain, the amount of liquid in the lake remains what it is. Because of the interaction called rain, the water in the cloud depletes, sometimes to such an extent that the cloud vanishes, the water in the lake increases. Sometimes if initial water is zero, a lake is formed. That is one analogy. And the second thing which we should talk about is there is a neat situation where a small movement of the boundary converts a work interaction into a heat interaction. And the situation is that of a break. Consider a simple situation. Nowadays, mobikes, particularly front wheels, have what is known as a disc brake. Okay. Very clearly seen, open mechanism, so that's an advantage. Otherwise, drum brakes are inside the hub, we don't even see what that mechanism is. So now consider a situation where I am simplifying it. I have this disc which I am considering as a plate, and this is the shoes which are holding it together. Okay. And the plate is being moved. I want to know what is the interaction between the plate and the shoe. Is it a work type of interaction or is it a heat type of interaction? And let us assume that the shoes are fixed to some body, the structure of the car or the motorcycle, and the plate is moving because it is connected to the wheel. Ask them to do the problem using two system diagrams. In one case, say that the system is the plate itself and nothing else, and say that the system boundary is just inside the surface of the plate. This is one. Ask them to redo the problem and say that now the system boundary, instead of just inside the plate, I am extending it slightly into the shoe. This is case A, this is case B. I will leave it to you as an exercise to do this today evening. Think about it, discuss among yourself. And don't be surprised if you come to the conclusion, the correct one is, in case of A, the interaction is a work type of interaction. In case B, the interaction is a heat type of interaction. And all that we have done is moved the boundary of our system by maybe just a fraction of a millimeter. But this also means that if I make an adamant choice that the boundary of my system is exactly on the interface of the brake and the shoe, then I am at a situation where I do not know whether my interaction is purely a work interaction or purely a heat interaction. But if I move it slightly into the shoe, it is heat. If I move it slightly into the plate, it is work. This is an excellent illustration that work is an interaction, depends not only on the two systems, but on where the boundary is located. Of course, when you move the boundary, we are also changing the definition of our system, because a system is defined only by its boundaries. But this emphasizes on the student the importance of laying out the boundaries precisely. Because if two students assume two different sets of boundaries, hence two slightly different systems, the answer can be totally different. In one case, somebody will say, oh, it is a proper work interaction. The other one will say, where is the work interaction? This is purely a heat interaction.